Digital 410 Media proudly presents the What's the Scuttlebutt Podcast with your hosts, Don Abernathy, Jeff Copsetta, and Dennis Blocker.
And I came back 2 years later teaching English as a volunteer at a church, and I met my first Japanese veteran. His name was Yoshida. He was a cavalryman in China. He had a photo album with all kinds of great pictures of Japanese soldiers like brushing the manes and cleaning the horses, you know, hooves and arranging tack and everything. And at the time, I remember thinking, wait a minute, where's all the babies being stabbed? Where's all the children getting their heads cut off? Wait a minute. These are pictures of the guys smoking cigarettes, hugging each other, laughing, riding horses, feeding horses. And I'm like, this doesn't make any sense to me. And I was honestly confused. So I went, okay, what I've been led to believe is true about the Japanese, the soldiers, and what I experienced with Mr. Yoshida, his English was zero. My Japanese was almost zero. He attended the church that I was volunteering at. And so I said, well, I got to learn more. And to learn more, I had to learn the Japanese language. So when I went back home, I got my degree in Japanese from Cal State LA. And my professor was a kamikaze pilot.
Oh, wow.
He was 16 years old, volunteered for the kamikaze program out of Koroma City, which is now Toyota, which is where I went and worked and lived for 10 years. It's weird things kind of come in circles like that.
Wow.
What year was this roughly? Just because I'm trying to think.
1981.
So
Japan. Yeah, I was 16.
37 short years after the war.
It was, yeah, there was veterans everywhere.
Well, the reason I bring this up is you said you went over there and you're expecting to see what you saw representation of all the things you mentioned. And I was thinking, well, is this 50 years later? Is that generation past? No, 30 some years later, those people are still around. So it wasn't a cultural shift. It was, oh, yeah, we had propaganda here too.
You know, my general manager at Toyota where I worked, he was a survivor of the A-bomb. And he was 5 years old when the A-bomb was dropped at Hiroshima. And he lost his dad and his brother. And I didn't know that until I'd worked for them for 5 years. And one night I was at his house and we're having a little dinner party and he got really drunk and he starts talking about the bomb going off and what it looked like and what it sounded like. And my mind was blown. And I thought,
wow,
this guy has been the nicest boss to me. He's always protecting me from my assistant manager, who was really not a friendly guy. He always stood up for me. He always kind of protect me, make sure I got good training classes. He was like an ally. And here he had lost half of his family during the A-bombs, but he'd never talked about it. And it was so interesting. The Japanese tend to keep their personal stuff hidden away. They don't bring it out in the open.
Well, that kind of answers a question that I had popping up, which was going to be, did you experience maybe resentment, if you will, from not everybody, but from a few Japanese veterans? Because, for example, I know growing up in Kentucky, back when Karate Kid was huge, my grandfather fought in World War II. I went to the Richwood Flea Market. I bought me a bandana, had Japanese writing on it because Karate Kid was cool. My grandmother's like, hey, you don't have no idea what that says. She still had a little bit of, you know, PTSD from living through the war. So I was kind of curious, did you kind of get any little hostility from maybe some of the older Japanese veterans towards you simply for being an American?
The only time I got any kind of hostility was I went to the Yasukuni Shrine in 1990, I think, and it was August. It was the end of the war, and there were two large veteran groups assembled, and there was one all dressed in Navy uniforms, mostly, you know, reproductions, but some originals, and there's a group of Army guys dressed in all original stuff. So I went up to the Navy guys and I was like, you know, hey, my name's Dan. What are you guys doing? What's your deal? Were you guys in the Navy? And just kind of, you know, talking to them. Yeah, they were very open, very friendly, chatty. And I took pictures with them. Then I went to the Army group and they all turned their backs on me. And I was like, they accidentally turned their backs on me. So I walked around to the front and I said, hello, excuse me. And they turned their backs on me again.
Wow.
So one of the Japanese Navy guys came running over. He grabbed me by the shoulder. He goes, come on, come back and hang out with us. They're jerks. Don't worry about them. They're Army guys. And that was the first time I'd experienced the mindset of the Japanese Navy versus the Japanese Army.
Oh, wow.
The Japanese Navy, you know, they had to study English. And a lot of them had been to America before the war because they had these annual cruises for the midshipmen. They'll take them to Europe or Africa or Egypt or South America. And they have traveled the world. They've seen foreign countries. And these guys are pretty globalized, so to speak. They were more open to foreign people. And but the army guys, from the people I met, were generally not receptive to talking to non-Japanese people and had a little more resentment. And the more, as years went by, I realized that more and more of the Navy guys I met lived on ships or lived in airfields. And so they had, clean beds, clean sheets. They had pretty good food. They never actually saw the enemy. They never actually saw the American troops. So maybe the army guys, they was a more of a nitty-gritty, dirty kind of. So maybe
Wow,
that
yeah.
could have something to do with it. Well, the army guys, they were very strictly, very old school samurai mindset, is everything Western is bad. So they were harder to interview than the Navy guys. But I've been lucky enough to interview 105 Japanese combat veterans, and I've started putting their stories as they tell them to me in book form. And I remember, if I may, there was one, this is one book, The Last Zero Fighter. And there was a naval pilot named Mr. Kaname Harada, and he flew in the Pearl Harbor attack as combat air patrol, and he was in the battle for Wake Island, the air battle. And I said, Mr. Harada, I'm going to tell your story as you tell it to me. So anything good and bad, it's going in the book. So if there's anything you don't want to tell me or you want me to know, put it in. And he's okay. So I went to his home, and we were there for several hours. And then he says something about, oh, yeah, Nanking, blah, blah, blah. And I go, wait, 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 Nanking? You were at Nanking? He said, oh, yeah, I saw it. I saw it. I was there. Yeah, I was on the ground. He said, yeah, we bombed it from the air. We dropped bombs on the walls so the troops could get over it inside of the city. And after the battle, we landed at the airfield after the army captured it. And we took a truck into the city, and we wanted to see our bombs, were they short, were they long, did they hit well? Just to become a better pilot, we went in to see where the bombs had struck. And he goes, and then I saw something really horrible. The army guys were cutting people's heads off and stabbing them and slaughtering people, innocent people. And he t tells me the story, and I hit the I paused the I recording device, and I said, Harada-san, this is going to go in the book if you tell me this. He goes, people need to know. He said, Dad,
Wow.
I saw it, I heard it, I smelled it. It happened. There are a lot of Japanese who say it didn't happen. It's like in Japan, the apologists are saying, oh, Nanking didn't happen. It was an exaggeration. But he said, I was there. And so to me, that
Wow.
was really valuable because he was there. And when he was telling me the story, he was staring off into the distance, and he was just like remembering it, talking about it.
My goodness. I think it's also
And
important to share that so that the reader and people know that just because these atrocities were going on at the hands of some Japanese soldiers and some participants, that not all the Japanese soldiers agreed with what was going on and not all of them participated
He
in
was
it.
very upset. He was very upset. He and the other naval pilots were standing there on the river. My wife and I went there to see it firsthand because she's from Taiwan, so she speaks Chinese. So I wanted to go to Nanking. We spent 3 days there looking all everything, all the places I'd read about, the river, the walls, the gates, everything. I wanted to see it firsthand. And that was something that I've always wanted to do was you read the history, right? And then you meet the veterans, American or Japanese, you meet them, you hear their stories. And I used to be a collector, so I would collect the items that they used, uniforms, rifles, swords, canteens, things like that. So when they tell their stories, you can go, oh yeah, I know that. Your canteen holds about a quart. And they're like, oh yeah, okay. And then the wall comes down. Or when a Japanese naval pilot says, well, I flew the Zero. That's an airplane. I'm like, yeah, I know. It's whatever, AMC, but and they go, oh, you know the Zero? Yeah. And then another wall drops. And I found that the more I knew about their uniforms, equipment, and weapons, that the walls dropped and they would be more open to share and talk with me. And I think it's really important as a historian, as a history buff, to learn as much as you can up front before you actually talk to a veteran so that they're not like wasting their time explaining, what something like, an M1 Garand. is, because you, I have one. I've shot it. I know what it's like. So that was
That's
kind of like
most
a
valuable
school of
information.
games, you know?
Dan, did you go into the caves at Saipan? Did you get and
Oh
visit
yeah.
all
Yeah.
those?
I was there last March for a week. I'm working on a new book about the Japanese tanks on Saipan and Guam. So this is a Type 97 Japanese tank, right? Okay. So the movie Windtalkers, some loved it, some didn't. I was a technical advisor, the Japanese advisor. So all the Japanese stuff, uniforms, equipment, the letters you see, photographs, all that was me. I was involved in California and Hawaii. And I remember I was at the warehouse, and they had made these three Japanese tanks. And I went in to go check on them because I'd given them like the images, the things to paint on the tank, right? And the camouflage colors from Tamiya. I gave them Tamiya samples to use. And there was a big Japanese flag on the side of the turret. And I go, what's this? This is not what it's supposed to look like. This is not what I gave you. And this gentleman said, well, you know, we're really busy, and I couldn't find the file. So this is good enough. It's just Japanese tanks. No one's gonna know. And I said, someone's gonna know. Someone in Japan is gonna see this movie. And if we put the correct markings on, somebody will see that and say, wow, look at that. You gotta go see this movie. It's great. And this word of mouth will spread, and it'll give a credibility to the film. And director John Woo said, you have to make it accurate. He was very, very strict about that. So he's like, ah. I said, I'm gonna have to go talk to John Woo about this. He's like, ah. So they had to hire a painter in Hawaii to repaint the tank and put the correct hiragana markings on it for the 5th Company, 9th Tank Regiment, which is in Saipan. So fast forward a year later, the Japanese survivor named Shiro Shimoda is in Osaka watching a film with a tank buff, a young guy, and they're watching this movie called Windtalkers, and a tank goes by the screen. And Mr. Shimoda lights up and he goes, that's my tank. It's his tank regiment. It goes up,
Oh,
blows up. So the young man Kitagawa-san finds me through the internet, and he says, Mr. Shimoda wants to thank you for accurately portraying his tank regiment.
this has been a Digital 410 production.